I think that when we talk about, well, what are some practical tips that I as a provider can really use in working with individuals who are different from me, and no diversity roadmap or guidebook can really answer all the questions to how we should work with people different from ourselves. So going back to Alzheimer's disease, you know, in the course of the disease, every decision that families make has a cultural influence. And again, if you think about filial piety, the way that notion is so ingrained in Chinese culture, it has a huge influence on people's decisions. So for example, once someone is diagnosed, one of the big questions is who is going to provide the care for this individual? That's a big question, and it's not always an assumption, whether it's the wife or a certain child. So it's a cultural decision that really has to involve the entire family. Another question will be, where will this person reside? You know, whether to move them or not. Is the person going to stay in the home or live in a nursing home? And many Chinese families will say, well, we will try and keep this person at home for as long as possible. It's something that is so ingrained, not just in that family, but in their whole community, where if you don't care for that person in the home, you may be seen as a failure. So it's a very tough decision for families. So I think that when we're working with families through the journey of Alzheimer's, it's all the decisions are really up to that family to make. And the best we can do is guide them and walk with them through that process, looking at what the options are, looking at whether there are culturally sensitive, culturally relevant programs available. An example would be, adult daycare is a wonderful concept, a wonderful program. But if the program center doesn't have any staff, program staff that speak that individual's language, whether it's Cantonese or Mandarin, it's likely not going to be a very comfortable place for that family to send their loved one. So those are some options. Similarly, in looking at facilities, sometimes people have to move their loved one outside of the home, and it's our job to really help the family understand that it's not necessarily a failure, especially if you're looking at the individual's safety and health first. So those are important things to really reiterate with families. Some general notions, you know, when we're talking about culture, is really thinking about, is it my culture that's being emphasized here in this decision, or is it their culture? And so it's really important to take the time to get to know your patient or your client, really taking that time at the beginning, 10 minutes, 15 minutes, to listen to this person's story, to understand this, who this person is, not just their condition and level of functioning, because it builds trust. And it also sets the foundation for harder decisions to come and for more difficult conversations that may come up later. For example, dealing with end-of-life care, that's a really tough conversation to bring up and to have openly. So I have here some examples of questions because, again, we don't expect providers to know everything. Country of origin, immigration history, how this has impacted the family are really important, right? Again, cultural influences in their decisions. Also being knowledgeable about the family structure and decision making, because oftentimes if a Chinese family subscribes to the traditional roles within the family, even though it's the father who or the mother who has Alzheimer's, it may be the adult son that makes the decisions. So it doesn't matter if you're talking to the youngest daughter who came to you for help. It may be that you need to talk to the oldest son because he's the one who makes. So it's important to find out this aspect. And then also learning more about what type of treatment do they subscribe to? Because it's very common for Chinese families in the United States to combine Western medicine and also traditional Chinese medicine. And often families may not tell you this. The patient may not bring up that they use Chinese medicine for any of their conditions that they have. So if you pursued it as, I know it is a common practice to use Chinese herbal medicine for ailments, do you use any in addition to prescribed medicine? It may open up the door because then the person will think, oh, you do understand that this is something that is widely used and I can talk about it with you. And then be aware of your communication style. The one thing I would just emphasize here is that it's important to assure patients of confidentiality. If they have come to you and have really opened up, just remember that it may have been very difficult for them to share their information with you because of that whole taboo around sharing family information outside. And then the other piece is relating caregiver information back to patient care. So an example would be support groups. We have support groups at the Alzheimer's Association. Our Chinese support groups tend to fare better if there is a topic and a speaker, because what we have found is that caregivers may feel like if I'm only there to open up my story and to share, it's not useful, not a good use of my time. But if I am learning something about caregiving that will help the person I'm caring for, then that is a worthwhile use of my time. I'm going to just briefly say that acculturation is always a consideration when working with families of any background, including Chinese, Chinese American families, and to just recognize that even though someone who has been here for 40 years may still rely on Chinese media and their Chinese network of friends and family for health information, caregiving information. So not to assume that they only subscribe to Western notions of care.